Maybe just introduce the editorial that I have with me. I have Dr. Abbas Great, who is a representative of the president of IFRC and former vice president of IFRC and the former secretary general of the Kenyan Peace. I'm also Dr. Mike Charles, who is IFRC head of Southern Africa Cluster Office in South Africa, who's with us. Our secretary general, Mr. Edgar Lungu. We have Ronya Binga, IFRC Operation Coordinator, which she shares us name. Then we have Cosmas Benzu, our national vice president, Mr. Brad Chula, national financial person, and his father, Miranda Mula, is our financial chairperson. And now Mr. Kamangachesa, who is responsible for the officer. In our meetings, we also have our communications manager, Ms. Esther Pierre, as well as our deputy secretary general, Mr. Cosma Sakara. This is the whole delegation that we have, Your Excellency. And just to start with Your Excellency, may I take this opportunity and their privilege that on behalf of this delegation from the Zambia Red Cross Society and its regional partners, please allow me to proffer our profound appreciation for your gracious acceptance of our request for an audience with you as our patron. Your Excellency, as you may be aware, Zambia Red Cross Society is a humanitarian and institutional auxiliary of public authorities in the mandate and its mandate to alleviate human suffering. The society was formed in 1966 by an Act of Parliament, that is the Red Cross Act, Cap 307 of the Laws of Zambia, and is a member of the International Federation of the Red Cross and Red Crescent. In its auxiliary role, Zambia Red Cross Society enjoys work closely with the Ministry of Health and other line ministries, and the disaster management and mitigation unit under the office of the Vice President. And this Zambia Red Cross Society is an important conduit for social economic assistance for various vulnerable communities across the country. A multitude of cooperating partners and well-wishers, both from within the movement and outside it, channel their contributions to a number of humanitarian causes in Zambia through the Zambia Red Cross Society. Your Excellency, sir, may I also mention here that in just the past 3 years, the society has raised over 70 million through international partners and donors from various humanitarian services, both in emergency and non-emergency situations. Such humanitarian services include response to disaster like effects of climate change, such as floods, droughts, and food insecurity. Other service areas include refugee support, prevention and control of epidemics such as cholera outbreaks and the COVID-19 pandemic which we are faced with at the moment, as well as programs that aim at health promotion and improving livelihood of vulnerable members in our communities in the country. However, such funds, Your Excellency, are restricted and cannot be used for any other operation or administrative purposes outside what is prescribed by our donors or our partners. From some of these activities that we have undertaken, we have seen that in response to the drought and food security situation in Kalabo, that is in Western Province, the National Society reached over 4,000 households with emergency cash transfer. Through this intervention, we contributed to the efforts of the DMI in mitigating livelihood and humanitarian risk to the affected populations. Your Excellency, sir, through this and many other programs across the country, the Zambia Red Cross has been one of the main humanitarian organizations in the country, helping address vulnerabilities in various Zambian communities. But I may be failing in my duties, Your Excellency, If I do not mention the challenges that we have been having in Zambia Red Cross Society. Over the past 5 years, Zambia Red Cross has been facing the consequences of legacy of mismanagement and legal difficulties that in the optimal operation of the society. These consequences have taken the form of the build-up of debts and reduction in the flow of funds to the national society. The legacy has led to the following challenges, Your Excellency. The required settlement of legal cases that have been concluded and decided against the society due to poor representation. This I must honestly mention that though certain cases have been concluded, but we still feel, I think, as a society, we have had some representation, even where cases were straightforward for us to win, but we've been losing these cases. There's also loss of property, which I think this also culminates in the mismanagement that we've had in the past. There is also high statutory and operation indebtedness. Your Excellency, just as I mentioned earlier on, these are some of the difficulties that the society is going through. The cash flow challenges due to the reduced investment has also contributed in ourselves facing so many challenges that we need to be addressed. There is also a dented image as a result of the past negative publicity which we have experienced. I'm sure this has been a part of, and I'm sure most of the maybe of some of these challenges of our dented image in terms of integrity and whatever might have come to your ears. But nevertheless, there are some corrective actions that we have undertaken as a society. Your Excellency, the National Society has not stood by and idly watched this question worsen. The National Society has taken various steps to reform operations and improve its fortunes going forward, and some of these steps include the following. We've taken an ambitious recovery plan that has put the National Society on a more productive and responsible footing to address the future challenges, including the ones that have been passing through. We're also looking at strengthening the human resource capacity and financial control system to foot the accountability. I think in the financial control system, this has been the major problem that we have been having for the past few years, which we are looking forward to see how we can manage this thing that has been going on. We are also looking at enhance our visibility so as to foster transparency and develop our image. And you being the patron, I'm sure we'll see how we move forward with you, that is your Excellency. We're also looking at improving on our governance by implementing a more robust constitution which reflects our current aspiration as a society. There are so many gaps that were seen in our constitution, of which the process has already begun, in which we have to harmonize our constitution in regard to what is coming to obtain. And to engage the parties in our various legal predicament and found amicable out-of-court settlement, which we have settled with. I think most of these cases the rulings have already been done, and they are linked with the people that we owe some of this money. I think an out-of-court settlement, which some of the people that we have settled for that, I think we are also looking into how we shall clear this debt. We have also embarked on various fundraising ventures to improve cash flow and investment, of which this is one cardinal point that we are looking at, Your Excellency, and see as a patron how we could come in with this intervention. Your Excellency, despite looking at this thing, we also need maybe your indulgence. Despite the highlighted and other corrective actions taken, the National Society is still struggling with high level of indebtedness and various cash flow challenges. The Zambia Red Cross Society has raised a considerable amount of funds for various projects and intervention over the years, of which some most of this, which is coming from our partners and the donors. I think I would even fail here if I don't mention the Netherlands Red Cross and the IFRC have been coming to our to end most of the programs that we are carrying out. However, as previously noted, such funds are restricted in how they are applied and can never be used for administrative and other purposes. This problem is further complicated by a steady reduction in funding over the years as donor and other partners face challenges of their own and expect the National Society to contribute more from their own resources. I think we've seen even in most cases that there is donor fatigue, whereby at least every time and again we are just moving with a board to ask for handouts. This is the issue that we need to change the Zambia Red Cross Society as we put our heads together and see our way forward. Given this status quo, the National Society has to rely on its own fundraising initiative to manage its own operation and administrative needs. With the foregoing background, we seek Your Excellency, Your Indulgence, and Your good office as the Republican President and Patron of the Zambia Red Cross Society to assist us in the following ways where possible, Your Excellency. A consideration to increase our allocation of government subvention through the Ministry of Health from the current 33,000 a month to roughly around 500,000 a month to enable the National Society to cover its own basic operational needs. This increase would also contribute to enhancing our effectiveness and efficiency in addressing the many challenges and vulnerabilities in our communities. We're also looking at securing a debt relief and risk plan for the Zambia Red Cross. Zambia Red Cross owes Zambia Revenue Authority 2,515,546 kwacha, and NAPSA 3,689,460,000 in outstanding contribution and various penalties, among other liabilities accrued over the years. We hope that your office could facilitate the right of for the penalties and interest related to these debts as the National Society continue to pay the principal amount. Your Excellency, as they say, this will find it because of the mismanagement, but we are looking forward to how we shall respond to this.
You're not alone.
But Your Excellency, grant us an audience. We are also appealing for you to grant us an audience at least once in a year, so that as an association or the society, we'll be able to finish you with what is going on the ground, and you being your partner, so that you are blessed with the information and what you have been doing as a Zambia Red Cross Society. And not to forget that as we move into harnessing our resources, we are also looking at hosting a fundraising dinner to crown you, Your Excellency, as the patron of the Zambia Red Cross Society. I think in line with this, we thought that we also invite the first African president, who was the first patron, to also crown you, and we cannot do that without the indulgence of your office. And this is our appeal to you, Your Excellency, that at an appropriate time, which you think maybe we can do this honor, you will let us know, since we are children and you are our patron, and we know that you have always had a busy schedule, but we are looking forward to seeing it, that at an appropriate time when you feel, I think it's appropriate for that to come into this presentation of honoring you and the first president. We'll be waiting for your response, sir. This intervention from your office would not only relieve the National Society as a massive financial burden, but would also improve its capacity to attract even more investment to fund its activities as a humanitarian organization. Your Excellency, this would be made possible by the reduced risk profile and greatly enhanced image of the National Society as a result of your involvement as a patron of the Zambia Red Cross Society. And before I could thank Your Excellency, we would love to take much of your time. We know of your busy schedule, I would like to thank you most sincerely once again for affording us this opportunity to meet you and present our case to you as our patron. And maybe before you could respond to what I've said, just as I earlier mentioned, to say in our meetings we have our delegates from IFRC. We have Dr. Great. I think he maybe could also share with you what he has and then present what he has. Dr. Great.
Thank you. Your Excellency, I speak before you, sir, with a lot of humility and respect. And first and foremost, I come in two versions. The version number one is I come from Kenya. I used to work for the Red Cross in Kenya and the International Red Cross. My association with the Red Cross spans about 47 years of service, both as a volunteer, where I came from in Mombasa in Kenya, which I know you know, and then as a paid staff of the Kenya Red Cross, as a young person in the early 80s, and then working for the International Red Cross, IFRC in Geneva, and in many parts of the world that I've been fortunate enough to work in all corners of the world. At the end, I decided to go back home because I believe in, as a Kenyan, a very proud African, to go back and build my own society. And I was given an honor and opportunity to go and work for Kenya Red Cross. In the year 2000, Kenya Red Cross was equated to a leaking bucket. It was a mismanaged, misgoverned, and ruined society. But even before I say that to you, the first step is, I have a book here, which is a book on the Red Cross in Kenya that was published about 7 years ago as 50 years of Red Cross in Kenya, since the colonial day to independent Kenya. Now your brother and His Excellency President Uhuru Muigai Kenyatta had the pleasure of signing this book to you, because I came here in 2017, and unfortunately I did come to Statehouse, but due to national duties you were forced to be out of Lusaka, but I still came with the former Kenyan High Commissioner, Madam Sophie, who used to be here, that you know very well also, and it was also in relation to one of your former ambassadors, High Commissioner to Kenya, Madam Brenda, the late Brenda, who we became very close to work with in Kenya during disasters and crises in Kenya, that His Excellency wrote this book, A Message to You, where he says, my brother, an organization that is working to our efforts to solve the African problems, signed Statehouse, Nairobi, Kenya, 16th of January 2017, which is addressed to you, sir. So I will give this to the PS to bring it to you, sir, with humility and respect. A gift from your brother to you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
So, secondly, sir, like I said, I worked for the Red Cross for many years. And Kenya Red Cross is an institution that, like Zambia Red Cross today, in year 2001, was highly mismanaged, highly disorganized, highly corrupt organization. Mistake of Kenyans themselves who were entrusted to manage that institution. But Kenyans themselves decided at one point to change that paradigm shift, to say we cannot allow in this day and age for our institution to be mismanaged. Long story short, it had a date. But in a period of less than 20 years, today and my colleagues here who is representing International Federation of the Red Cross represent, that today Kenya Red Cross, not because I'm Kenyan, not because I was involved in it, but is the most highly respected, most organized, and financially going in the way of sustainability than any other country on the continent. The case of Zambia is a special case, Your Excellency. We as International Red Cross represent, where I was Deputy Secretary General some 12 years ago, and where I was also became Vice President about 8 years ago, has a lot of interest in Zambia and the Zambian Red Cross. But unfortunately, like many other countries on the African continent, I can tell you this with all honesty, Your Excellency, a lot of our societies on the continent have been mismanaged. Mismanaged by our own people, who have been entrusted in governance and in management. Governance are people who are elected by the membership, because Red Cross Red Crescent is the most grassroots-based organization anywhere in the world. It has the largest humanitarian forum. These are institutions that are enacted by an act of parliament. And I know as a legal person yourself will understand this very easy. Zambia Red Cross in 66 was enacted through an act of parliament that is auxiliary to the government of Zambia. The purpose of its work is to work hand in hand with the government to alleviate human suffering, whether it's a man-made or it is natural. For it to do so, in all countries, Your Excellency, the government gives salvation to the national society for its work, because it is doing this for and on behalf of the government. Government can't do everything by itself, but through agencies. That is why if you see today, whether it is DFID, whether it is USAID, whether it is JICA, these institutions that have been set up by this government, they finance both government and non-governmental organizations like the Red Cross. So in the case of Zambia, Your Excellency, again with respect and humility, I have followed up this society for the last 10 to 12 years. What we have seen is total mismanagement by individuals who have abused their position of power in management and in governance. This society was once upon a time society with resources. But today, its resources has dwindled because simply they have been abused. As the president said, there is land that was given by the government of Zambia before independence in 1958, where their current headquarters are. The government of Her Majesty for Northern Rhodesia gave land to the Red Cross in Zambia. That land was for the purpose of the humanitarian work of the Zambian Red Cross. Today we have a court case that individuals who are entrusted responsibility in governance and management went and sold that land on Los Angeles Boulevard. That land, Your Excellency, and that property was built by the Zambian Red Cross through donation from the Finnish Red Cross and the Finnish people. They had even rented the space to World Bank, who was paying them commercially very good rents for them to do their basic work. Unfortunately, that land was subdivided and sold. It was valued at 12.7 billion kwacha about in 2012, but it was sold under the table for 4 billion, Your Excellency. And we don't know how that transaction went. The matter has been taken to court, it is before court. The society, as the president said, have lost many court cases over the years because of poor representation and because those who mismanage the society are able to use the money they collected illegally to buy out, from what I'm being told, buy out the lawyers. And I'm sorry, Your Excellency, to say this, but since you are the patron and we need to bring this thing to your attention, sometimes even in the cases of judiciary, and this happens even in my country, in Kenya, Your Excellency, where these things do happen, we're all human beings. The point I'm trying to say, Your Excellency, is donors have fatigue now. We invested money because we believe in our brothers. I believe in Pan-Africanism, I believe in being your brother's keeper. We were paying even the salary of Secretary General, $6,000 a month, for a number of years. The Netherlands Red Cross have 10-year argument with the Zambian Red Cross. But again, whatever they put in doesn't stay. The problem is also the branches are very weak. They are not doing what they need to do. Lastly, on the issue of land, Your Excellency, there are more land that have been actually sold by the people who are in power. And they have made money. They still taunt us. Today, there is an out-of-court settlement.
People who are in power, like me.
Yes, sir. People who are in power at that time, who until today, Your Excellency, are making money out of this society for doing nothing, for having looted. They took the society to court. The society lost its court cases. They have now resorted to settle outside court, and they have to pay thousands of kwacha every month now to the same people who are taunting them, who actually looted money from this organization, Your Excellency. Your Excellency, I have here a forensic audit report, huge book, done by PricewaterhouseCoopers in Zambia. It costed Kenya Red Cross $100,000 to do this forensic audit. Accounts were not being kept. Records are destroyed. People are doing things deliberately, and they are there. So I would just wanted to urge you, Your Excellency, in this case, you as a patron, like in Kenya, your brother is a patron of Kenya.
why has the public not been told about this?
And because we are afraid, Your Excellency, because we are afraid to speak loud as Red Cross, but we are saying enough is enough. They have been in the media previously, even before you became the president, these things were in the media. And today, you can challenge Mr. President of the society and his board, what are they doing? So I can give you an example, Your Excellency. Internationally, we are willing to work with this society.
Only yesterday.
But we need to help.
Only yesterday.
But we need
Only yesterday in here, I said the problem we have in this country is that the fight against corruption has been corrupted. This is exactly what you are saying.
Yeah.
Now,
exactly.
You are talking of conspiracies between the lawyers who represent the society and those in power, and in the end, the courts are being implicated. At the end, the poor society just has to sign a consent order at the end of paying, and we have to look for money to pay.
Yes.
It's corruption and it's waste. What more corruption evidence do you need than that? So such people should be named and shamed so that if the courts of law do not convict them, the courts of public opinion convict them, so that at the end of the day they cannot walk with their heads high and be the role model for which people should try to emulate. It's a shame. But you see, you have confessed, the new management of the society has confirmed that they want to change the transformation, to transform this society and be seen for what it is, integrity, you know, accountability, and the need to support human humanitarian causes. And I think that's the way to go. There has to be a point when you say, we are breaking with the past, and I think you are the team which will break with the past. So for me, whilst here, I would support you. If it means revisiting some of these cases, as long as we're not told, no, this is statute bad, you should have come to court within 12 months or 12 years, we can start these cases, why not? Because fraud is fraud. And if people's property has been vandalized or stolen, we should be up to the task by saying we have done our best as a society, only that the law has failed us. In this case, if the law fails you, we'll say, can Parliament change the law? Because you haven't fought enough. I know about property, the issue of property. When I became president, I learned how property has been squandered, you know, stolen, if I may use the term, from the society. And people are watching. And the people who stole these are still with us, and they are free. And some of them are aspiring to public office, and you want to continue saying it's business as usual. If you want to be the people who say the change, the difference, you have to speak out and say, we found this. Are we still going to pretend that this didn't happen? Or should we reopen it? If we can't reopen it, why? The House of Parliament is sitting, it's there, it's there to change the laws. If the laws don't help the people because they are moribund or they are still in the medieval days, we are supposed to go to Parliament and say, this law must change. I know the plight of the Zambia Red Cross Society because I found it when I became president. Lots and lots of property has been stolen from the society by people who are charged with the responsibility and trusted to look after the affairs of the society. So now here we are, 2020, we're still crying. We can't cry forever. We can't cry forever. We need to name and shame the people involved. And if the law is the hindrance, we go back to the lawmakers and say, can we change the law so that these people are held accountable and answer to the rightful owners of this property, the Zambian people. And I think that's what we should be doing. If we're going to be the transformation of our generation, we have to be brave.
Your Excellency, I have two things I want to say. Number one is to say, like this piece of land which the government gave, I know even in Kenya, even for user change of the land, we have to go back to Ministry of Land. The government gave the land for humanitarian work. Now someone comes and build a building for you to use to make an income. And then you just go and set it under the table. Because there was also a bank involved. And there was under the table between the buyer and the seller. I would urge Your Excellency, some of these things, if it is still possible, within your powers, because I know the government has a long arm, and the long arm of the government will catch up with people at the end of the day. So I would say that with your blessings, if it is possible, I would ask for some of these matters. Your legal ministry can look at some of these things. Ministry of Interior can look at some of these things, if there is still a possibility. Because if the government gave the land for this purpose, and then it has been bought under the table, and now it is in court, and the Supreme Court the High Court is about to decide, I hope if there was any way, although you don't want to be seen as government to interfere with the judiciary, but if there is any way still possible, that is number one, I would ask Your Excellency with humility if that can be looked into. Number two, sir, with your permission. Now what I want to say is radical. And that is the only thing I believe can bring change. And it has happened in other countries in Africa. I'll give you other jurisdiction. In Liberia, 10 years ago during the Ebola cases in West Africa, the Liberian Red Cross leadership, both in governance and management, were involved in corruption. Your then sister, President Edgar Lungu Johnson, decided to disband the board and part of the management of the society were involved in that corruption. And by disbanding it, then the government instituted an interim board for 3 years to look at revamping the society from grassroots all the way to national. And the government was able to second senior people into the organization. We have just done similar thing in Sudan recently, in Khartoum, where I was involved also. So one plea that I have for you, now that the society has asked you to finance them, which I also humbly request you to do the same, one of the things you can do within your powers, because of integrity issues, and because the society is not able to meet its mandate of alleviating human suffering as agreed to the government, to the citizens of Zambia, the government can decide we disband the board, and then we put an interim board for 3 years, that you will have some of them here, you will have IFRC who is interested, even us who are involved with the society can support and advise you accordingly, but then you get a new interim board, you put them there for 3 years, you support them financially, they start changing this transformation you want to talk about. That is something I would personally request to Your Excellency, and it is within the law, because internationally matters integrity. If we fail in the Red Cross to deal with it as a Red Cross movement over the last 10, 12 years, because we are afraid of this certain individual, you as a government have the right and the authority. We are not interfering with your operation. You are saying there is too much corruption, too much integrity problem, you are not able to provide services, so we will change and reform and transform. This is not FIFA like in football where there are cartels and they will play. In the Red Cross, you can do the change itself.
It's not for me to say, but what you are talking about in Zambia replicates some cartel I know. Because there is no way the society can fail to get justice unless the players are all compromised. Here you are talking of, you started by saying we have challenges, and one of them is mismanagement. That's the umbrella, mismanagement. And below there you started with legal cases. Yeah, you have been misrepresented terribly. And then there is an association called the Law Society or Law Association of Zambia, where aggrieved parties on account of misrepresentation by professionals such as lawyers can go and say, look, this lawyer is not worth the name. Can we be compensated? Just like medical doctors, you have got a body which deals with them. But here it's like you have lost cases because there has been a conspiracy. Yeah? From what I understand, involving some legal practitioners. And when you have a conspiracy between the client, the lawyer who is representing, and some powerful authorities, as you have already said, then there's no justice. So we cannot sit there and say, look, we have to wait, we have to wait. No. And that takes me to my friend, the PSC, Mr. Matenga. Where is investigative journalists? Because you are renowned, I know you from way back, you are a journalist, and some of the people we were talking to yesterday, your journalist friends, are still there. You embark on a case like that and say, I want to know what happened to these buildings, these properties, which were owned once by Zambia Red Cross Society. Who stole them? Who stole from the people? And you do intensive journalism and investigation, and you write about it, so that in the court of public opinion, we know that this man is not honorable, he's just a thief. You know, that kind of thing should be done. If we can, that's the power of the press. The fourth estate is the media. And if the media does not help us, they just talk about corruption on the surface of it, corruption on the surface of it. And yet they know that there's a good case here of corruption and people have lost property. And they sit back and they say, no, there's corruption. They should be the ones who help us so that if there are shortcomings in the process of prosecution or investigation, we know where the problem is and we approach this hurdle so that in the end people have justice. What I cry for is a situation where corruption is fought in earnest and with integrity, not just smearing each other with corruption, wanting to get into public office, and when you get there, you continue with corruption and so on. This is the problem we have in Zambia today. There are so many people who cry, woof, 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 when actually they are the wolves. And in the end, when you all go to sleep, they end up preying on you, eating everything that you have worked for. This is exactly what we are talking about. The Red Cross Society case is still alive, and I think somebody should tell us what went wrong. And at the end of the day, if the law which is inadequate, we challenge Parliament to change the laws. Here I am, I'm talking about, no, fraud which happened 12 years before cannot be investigated, you cannot be brought to prosecution. That's what I'm being told. As of yesterday, somebody was telling me that, Mr. President, you're a lawyer. If a case goes for 12 years, you haven't prosecuted it, most fraud, then you can enjoy the proceeds of the fraud. That's what I've been told, according to all statutes which are applicable to Zambia. So in short, I'm saying this fight is for all of us, our friends who support us, such as yourselves, the Zambian people, and all. But if we gloss over it and say it happened, it's Edgar Lungu to fight, I can't fight alone. Because here we are. This particular case, you are saying the courts are going to adjudicate and make a decision. If they make a decision, fine, we'll respect it. But if the court of public opinion will be grumbling and complaining that that's not justice, then we have a problem. We have a problem. Then the people who are charged with the responsibility of amending the laws should quickly change the law so that the people get justice. You know, you cannot technically lie behind the worn out law which says after 10 years you can enjoy the proceeds of crime. This is what we are getting. So I am saying that I'm glad that the management now of the society is alive to this. Let us work together. Let us not rest. Let us fight until we get back what belongs to us. You're talking of banks. Banks are very powerful. They go under the table, they deal, they get your land. And the people in the Ministry of Land, for example, also connive. They give you. At the end of the day, it's the whole cartel of people. But the danger of this is that the support that we get from our donor friends, our supporters like yourselves, when and eventually it declines and completely goes into extinction and we don't get the support, so the society fails to deliver its mandate. And this is what we're experiencing now. I would like to assure you that reforms, Mr. President, of Zambia Red Cross Society should not be undertaken on face value. They should be deep so that we get to the bottom of this. And if we need the help of the judiciary, let the judiciary help us. If we need the help of the legislature, let the legislature help us amend the law so that crime is stopped, is checked before it takes root, so that those who have been found wanting in terms of criminal liabilities are brought to book, and there is restitution to the people whose property has been stolen. So this is what I learned from here. But I'm glad that you have come through, and I'm glad that you have highlighted your problems. And through this interaction, I'm sure most Zambians will take note and interest, particularly the media, PS, my thing. The media, what has happened? Who owns the shop next door? we had people who run with articles like that and show us, veil the cut, you know, cut through the corporate veil and go beyond that, see who the shareholders are, and everything else. It's possible. It makes the journalism interesting and exciting. We no longer have that. But let me just confirm that all I can say, the take of this discussion is that I will take note of your submission in totality. I will take note of your submission in totality, and I will engage the OVP, Office of the Vice President, DMMU, and also other line ministries so that we get to top of things. And we are in this together. All stakeholders are in it, and I think everyone of us should play our part. But the most important thing is that you should always highlight your plight. And if you don't, as a society, people will think, oh, it's well. We see you doing your work day to day, and we think, oh, it's well. But the public should be made aware from time to time. We say, here we are, this is the problem we have. I keep giving this story of a mother who had twins. One was very friendly, never crying, always quiet, subdued, and all. The other was always crying to get the breast and feed and so on. The one who was not crying eventually died, you know. When they went to the hospital, they said, oh, this child is undernourished. The child is dead. The other one had two breasts to feed from, and he grew up to be a big man and powerful. So we have a duty to cry foul when we see things not going well. Instead of saying, no, the government will see, or others, donor societies will know, and so on. And the most important thing we need to know is that if we are of integrity, donors will be happy, they will support us, they will give us more and more support. If we are questionable, dubious, and apparently rotten to the core, they withdraw. In the end, we die. So all donors want integrity and accountability. Even me as a parent, if I give support to my children, I like those who account, those who are showing progress, those from time to time make returns to me. Those who don't, I'm not interested. So Zambians should know that there is a responsibility to all those who support us, so that at the end of the day, the support is appreciated by those people from wherever they're coming from. So I can only say that I am torn between two places, because I also need to raise money from the tax. I have to pay wages. The soldiers want to be paid. Teachers want to be paid. Hospitals have to be built, medicine has to be in school. So if somebody is burdened with tax liabilities and he comes to me and says, can we waive this? I think twice. I say, but where will the revenue tax get money from if we keep waiving? The same goes for NAPSA. The same goes for all these institutions which under statute and you are obliged to pay. Because if I begin saying, you know, can you remit this, can you cancel this and so on, I interfere with the Zambia Revenue Authority. In the end, there is no money coming in. In the end, we fail to get medicines in hospitals, doctors can't be paid, teachers can't be paid. We frustrate our men and women who are collecting revenue for us. So I think the best person to deal with it comes to write-offs or you know, staggering payments to tax office is the ZRA. So I believe Mr. Kingsley Chanda and his friends at NAPSA can always talk to you to see how we can help each other in meeting these obligations. I'm very reluctant to write off taxes because we need that money. I'll ask you to meet the Zambia Revenue Authority and Mr. Nakachinda, Director General of NAPSA, to just see how they can help you, considering that your cause is humanitarian, and I believe that we all appreciate the role that Zambia Red Cross Society plays in our day-to-day lives. You are our partners, and as patron, I can tell you that I agree with you, there's need to revamp the society and put it in the right place, and we can only do that together if we all play our role.
Your Excellency, again, with your permission, I'm sorry to come back on this, sir. One of the challenges we have, this current board, because of anomalies in the constitution of the society, and because of the weakness of our structures in the field, in our branches, this current board and the president who spoke to you this morning, he only had another 3 months. They were given 6 months to restructure the society. And after the 6 months, by July, they're going for another election. I believe they won't be ready because the issues are too deep. They have gone on for far too many years. This is why my dream with you, sir, to say, within your wisdom and powers, if you could, set up a new interim board that will give the society a space of 3 years to work on all these matters. Then it will work, because then they can go to the Ministry of Lands, for example. Can you imagine, Your Excellency, these people have lands everywhere in the country, but they don't have one title, one document. And these are things they need to work with the Ministry of Lands. They're the basic things, as you would say. But because of the frequent changes in leadership, in management, in government of the society, because they're not able to meet their obligation, it's been catastrophic. And this is why many donors have walked away. We want to bring back donors, but donors will only come back if they see serious involvement this time, even of the government. And you're right saying, Your Excellency, that you also have to raise money for your own citizens. All the 17 million Zambians look upon you. So the society, yes, they can get support, but if they get support from outside and it's not well managed, then we have a problem. So I want to look for a win-win situation. And with your permission, if it is possible, that is one thing I would really want to see if it can be an outcome. And that's something that the International Red Cross would support, Your Excellency. Because when you also put people there yourself, they will also report back to you to tell you we're actually on the right track, Your Excellency, that they are accountable to you as a patron. Because you also don't want to be a part of an institution that is totally mismanaged all the time. Every year they come back and it's the same challenges. So with humility, this is my one major request, Your Excellency.
I will go back to the statutes and see what power I have as patron. I also invoke powers as head of state. I will invoke all the powers available for the benefit of the Zambia Red Cross Society to ensure that we begin moving in the right direction. I will consult the Attorney General and others, because there are international IRFC regulations and conventions which you subscribe to. There is also the Zambia Red Cross Society Act, the Constitution of Zambia, all these things. So in exercising whatever power I have, I'll be very cautious not to transgress the law, but ensure that we get the best for the society, because the society means well for all of us. That I can assure you will do.
Liberia is a good example, Your Excellency. Sudan is a good example recently, and we'll work with you. We'll work with the society. We don't want to abandon the society, but we want to be given space, because the membership internally is where the problem is. People are bought to be voted. They buy their votes within the society.
That's corruption. That's corruption again. I thought this problem was for politicians alone. So they buy. Oh no! I think
we have to deal with it.
I think we have to do something better. We have to.
And your it's just a cabinet decision, Your Excellency. This one was done in Liberia on presidential decree, and in Sudan, the Prime Minister had a meeting, so it was a cabinet decision because I was involved with that decision, Your Excellency.
Yeah,
and there's nothing wrong because you just want a well-functioning society for the country. That's all. Nothing more.
I know you want to induce me to do something, but allow me to do it within the law. let me do it within the law. I take it that you want something done, but we'll do it within the law. Thank you so
thank
much.
You, sir.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Well, it's been a handful, but it just comes out to one thing, mismanagement. And that mismanagement, I think, we'll look into. But we know where it's coming from, and since we know where it's coming from, we can find a solution. So I promise that we'll look around and ensure immediate measures are taken in the interim and long term, so that we get going quickly, because we need this society to be up and working, and the people should have confidence in it, and that way we'll get more and more support from locally and the international supporters.
International.
Yes. So, it's been such a long time, but we have exceeded our time by far. All the same, because the matters you raised are so serious. But the president for the society was so nice. It had to take an outsider to tell me what it is. Why are you so diplomatic?
I'm an African, your president, and I believe Pan-African
is part of the society.
It's part of the society. So, you put him up to it. I think he's done a very good job, and those who didn't know what's going on now know, and those who want to help will help. So thank you so much.
Your Excellency, sorry, Your Excellency, I'm told there is a gift for, so maybe let me just invite whoever else to.
I think yes, thank you. And just speak from where you are, can I go again?
Where should you be?
First, we don't have time. Speak to the
Excellency. Your Excellency, my name is Edgar Lungu. I'm current Secretary General and the Chief Executive Officer of the Zambia Red Cross. It is my singular honor and privilege and pleasure, Your Excellency, to hand to you our strategic plan for the next 5 years, 2021 to 2025. That's it.
I will receive it. Thank you very much.
Yeah. And then we have a speech by the National President, which I will put here for you as well. Then we have a report for you, sir, Your Excellency, and then for your information. We know that you do have the watches and so on at Statehouse, but we feel that we can come in and make sure that you are not
prevalent.
Right. Okay.
But, and we have made sure that we have our post there to ensure that you came from Zambia Red Cross. Mm-hmm. It's a reminder of everything that you've been doing. We noticed that you do like wearing some capes, so we thought we should spend time in giving you our money.
Thank you.
You are also well known for being high on most of the time with the certain duties you have, and when you're doing Red Cross duties, we would really appreciate if you can find the reason to wear peace safari dress. I can only thank you for the motivation you have given us. I'm embarrassed to have myself, but very lucky
So and we are sure that we will follow what you have brought us. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. God bless you, gentlemen and ladies. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much.